intentional, never failing. I know that all things are working for my good. Yeah, she's intentional.
The Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Thank God for another day that the Lord has allowed us to see. Thank God for another opportunity that the Lord has given us. Praise God. Thank the Lord that it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Hallelujah. The Bible says that his compassion fails not, but his mercies are new every morning. Praise God. The writer picks it up and says, great is thy faithfulness. Sounds like you know a little bit about that. Praise God. Thank God the Lord is faithful to us. Don't you agree with that? The Lord is faithful to us. The Lord is kind to us. The Lord is good to us. And I've heard one person say, and I must agree, that when we say that the Lord is good, sometimes the word good is an understatement. Praise God. But I thank God. I thank God that he is God. And the Bible says that besides him, there is none other. Grace and peace be unto all of you, my brothers and sisters, from God our Father. Again, we greet you all in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, in whom we live, we move, and we have our being. Thank God for, again, this opportunity that the Lord has given us. We are so grateful. We are so blessed that the Lord has afforded us and have made it possible for us to be able to assemble together here in this hour, and to be able to worship the Lord through prayer, through the study of the word, and whatever it is that you have to offer to the Lord. I believe that he receives that as praise and as worship. And so I'm just so blessed of the Lord to be able to offer what it is that I have to the Lord, knowing that he will receive what it is that I offer to him. Praise God. And certainly to those that have joined in and that are joining in to our virtual means, we honor the Lord for you and we say God bless you. Thank God for you and thank God for your coming in and coming on with us here at this hour. And even if you are one of those who will be reviewing the playback, praise God, we honor the Lord for you as well. And we thank you for, number one, not thinking it or counting it robbery to be in fellowship with us here by these virtual means. We do not handle you, or we do not treat you as though you are a spectator, but we do believe that you are co-worshipers with us. And so therefore you are here because you desire to worship with us. And I believe, my brothers and sisters, that something good is going to happen to all of us. I believe that something good is going to happen to all of us. And so thank God. Thank God. As we prepare to begin and as we began to go into our prayer, the study of the word tonight, of course, we're going to begin by seeking the Lord, by calling upon the name of the Lord, dedicating time intentionally to speak with the Lord. And I bless God for the privilege of prayer. I really do. I thank God for the privilege of prayer. And I thank God for it because when we pray right and when we yield ourselves to the Lord Jesus, something happens in those moments of praying, in those moments of consecrating ourselves, in those moments of communing with God. And I'm still feasting even on Sunday how the Lord met us in prayer and how the power of God filled the room. Praise God. I thank God for it. I thank God for it. And I thank him for it because when we sense the presence of the Lord and the Lord begins to do what it is that he does and the Spirit of God begins to move, we can do nothing but, of course, honor the Spirit of God when he's in our midst. But then, of course, we yield to him because in yielding to him, what we're saying to the Lord is, number one, not my will, but thy will be done. But then secondarily, what we do when we're yielding ourselves to him, even in prayer, is that we are moving self out of the way and we're giving God that opportunity to say, here am I, Lord, do what you will, do what you will. And I say that because even in that moment of prayer, as I mentioned on this past Sunday, just before coming to the house of God, just before coming here, I mentioned to you about the messages and the phone calls that I received. And this is just a praise report that I want to insert here, because number one, the Bible does say to us to enter into his gates with thanksgiving. And so I believe that this is a good place to insert and to honor the Lord for what it is that he has done and that he's continuing to do. And there's a couple of them. As a matter of fact, Sister Evelina stopped me at the door on Sunday and asked me to pray for her daughter. There were some situations going on with her. And thank God that after being hospitalized for 3 days, Sister Fatima is home and doing well. And so I believe, thank God. Thank God for that. We praise God for it. And then as I was mentioning, the phone calls and the messages that I received concerning Brother Darian, I mentioned to you about the incident that occurred and how it is that he had to be hospitalized. And one phone call about them prepping him for surgery. By the time we got into the service arrived here, we got another phone call saying that there was no surgery needing to be had. Praise God. And then I said to you that there is another report that I'm expecting and that I'm waiting for, which is the report of victory. Praise God. Well, thank God that Brother Darian called me. I believe that was Monday morning around almost 10 o'clock. And he said, Pastor, he said, they'll get me together to send me on home. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said that they're going to keep me. He says it's probably going to be in the morning because they want to monitor me one more night to make sure all is well. But long story short, Tuesday afternoon sometime, he was released and he was sent home. And so, but we're still praying. We're still praying because there is a process in this from what he briefly described to me. And so we're believing God for total recovery. We're believing God for full healing. We're believing God that God is going to manifest himself, my brothers and sisters. And I know God to be the healer. Praise God. I know him to be the healer. And so I'm believing him. I'm believing him. And so as we prepare to pray tonight and as we prepare to move into this segment in which we have before the Lord, as we so often say that as we pray, let's be intentional about what it is that we are asking of the Lord. Let's be intentional about believing God. The Bible says, and, you know, these are classic verses that I often lift up pretty much before prayer. And the reason that I do that is because not just to remind you, but to build your faith in the areas in which you may be challenged or in the areas in which the enemy may want you to struggle. And, you know, you begin to hold back in terms of what it is that you're believing God for. But it is in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 11. Praise God. And around verse number 6, where the Bible says that without faith, it is impossible. Hallelujah. He says, but without faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. He goes on to say to us that he that cometh to God must believe. Praise God. Hallelujah. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. And so I believe that in our coming together, it is an indication and a symbol of our diligence in seeking the Lord. In other words, we are not just gathering just to have something to do, or we are not just assembling just because we need another religious activity to fulfill our time together. But my brothers and sisters, I believe that because we take time intentionally to say to the Lord that we are here and our being here shows our diligence. It is our diligence in seeking you. And if we seek you diligently, your word promised us that you will reward us. What is the reward? The reward is what it is that you're believing God for. Praise God. And so whatever it is that you're believing God for, whatever it is that you have before the Lord, that is your reward. And the Bible said that if we are going to come to God, we must come believing. Praise God. We must come believing and believing, number one, that he is God. But then secondarily, believing that he is going to fulfill what it is that you petition him for. In other words, if you believe that he's God, my brothers and sisters, then ultimately, because we know that God has everything and he is everything that we need, me getting God is me getting everything that I need. Hallelujah. And so he says that without faith, it is impossible, which means that, yes, we're going to believe God, but we also must have faith in God. That's what the word of the Lord tells us in the book of Mark, chapter number 11, and around verse number 21, 22. He says, but have faith in God. That's what Jesus said whenever he was coming and he cursed the tree from its roots. The Bible says that one of the disciples says to him, wait a minute, Jesus, I remember passing through here and you spoke to that tree and told it to dry up. Jesus did not say, oh, I did. Or he did not say, oh, you remember that? Jesus immediately answered the disciple and said unto them, have faith in God. In other words, what Jesus was saying was, have this kind of faith when you begin to speak against and speak on what it is that you're believing me for. That's all that Jesus was saying to those disciples. All he wanted them to understand was, don't be so surprised at what it is that I said, and then it begun to manifest. He said, don't be at all as to what it is that came out of your mouth, and then you begin to see that thing happen. He immediately said to them, have this kind of faith. And the kind of faith that we need, my brothers and sisters, is the same kind of faith that when Jesus spoke to that fig tree and told it to dry up from its roots, the Bible said by the time they came back through there, that tree was dried up from the root. And I want to say to somebody under the sound of my voice, just to encourage you, that when you begin to speak over what it is that you are expecting God to manifest in your life, and when you are speaking out a thing that you demand and command to die in your life, Jesus said it this way, have the kind of faith that I had in Mark chapter 11 and verse number 21. Hallelujah. And if you have this kind of faith, when you begin to speak to a thing, it's going to manifest just as though I said. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And so therefore, glory to God, when he says have this kind of faith, when he says have faith in God, Jesus is simply saying, hallelujah, get your faith to a level that when something flows out of your mouth, you don't have to second guess it. When it flows out of your mouth, you already know that it's already done in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. It's already done in Jesus' name. And so if that's what Mark is saying in Mark 11 and 22, hallelujah, if that's what Jesus says when he says, have faith in God, all he wants you and I to do is have this kind of faith. Glory to God. He wants you and I to have this type of faith. He wants you and I to have this type of faith. And he lets us know in Hebrews that without this kind of faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. It is impossible to please the Lord. And so we're going to speak to the Lord tonight. And in speaking to the Lord, we're going to speak to him. And we're going to speak believing God. We're going to speak believing God. We're going to speak trusting God. We're going to speak in faith. Glory to God. We're going to speak in faith. And faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And so therefore, I'm not speaking based off of what I see. I'm speaking based off of what I don't see, but what I am expecting to manifest. Glory to God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm speaking as to what I don't see in the natural eye, but I am speaking contingent upon what I am believing and what I do see in the realm of the spirit. And so therefore, if I see it naturally, it's not faith. Hallelujah. But if I see it in the spirit and I'm expecting God to manifest it, I'm going to speak by faith and believe God that when I speak it, it's going to be done. Hallelujah. When I speak it, it's going to be done. when I decree it out of my mouth, it's going to manifest. Father, thank you. Hallelujah. Father, in Jesus' name, we honor you and we thank you. We give you praise now for this opportunity that you have given us once again to be able to come together and to be able to call upon your name. I thank you for this privilege of prayer, and I thank you for this time that has been allotted unto us. Oh, God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. So that we can come together and so that we can call upon your name together, oh God. Yes, Lord. We know that your name is holy. We know that your name is righteous. Glory to God. We know that your name is above every name. And your word reminds us that it is at the name that is above every name. It is at the name of Jesus that every knee should bow and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ, he is Lord. We thank you tonight, oh God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. For ways that you have made and ways that you are making. We thank you for doors that you have opened and doors that you are opening. We thank you, oh God. Yes, Lord, for your hand upon our lives. And we thank you, oh God. Yes, Lord, for even the things that we may have taken for granted. But Father, we know that if it had not been the Lord who was on our side. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Your word says, now let Israel say that if it had not been for the Lord on our side, we know that if the enemy's plan would have worked, we know that if the plot in which the enemy has drawn up would have been fulfilled, we know that ultimately the enemy would have swallowed us whole. But oh God, I thank you for your grace tonight. I thank you for your mercy, oh God. Yes, Lord. I thank you, yes, Lord, because it is your love that fails not. It is your compassion that fails not. But Father, I thank you that your mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Your mercies are new every morning. And I thank you right now, oh God, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. I pray, oh God, that you will forgive us all of our sins and of our transgressions. We confess to you, Lord God, that we have sinned and come short of thy glory. We confess to you that not all of our words and not all of our deeds, not all of our acts, oh God, have been consistent with your word. But Father, I thank you because it is in the book of 1 John chapter number 1 and verse number 9 where your word says that if we would confess our sins, Lord God, you are faithful and you are just to forgive us and to cleanse us, oh God, from all unrighteousness. I thank you for your cleansing power tonight. I thank you for your hand, oh God, of grace and favor on our lives. I thank you, oh God, yes, Lord, that even when we acknowledge our sins and we acknowledge our transgressions, I thank you, oh Lord, because not once did you throw us away. I thank you, oh God, not once, oh God, yes, Lord, hallelujah, did you say you didn't want anything to do with us. But Father, I thank you for restoration today. I thank you for restoring your people, oh God. I thank you, oh God, for restoring us, oh God, even as David declared. David said, restore unto me the joy. Yeah, Lord, I praise you. I thank you for the joy being restored in the name of Jesus. And not only the joy, but Father, I thank you now for restoring your spirit in us, oh God. I thank you, yes, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Glory to God for breathing upon us, oh God, for breathing upon us afresh. In the name of Jesus, I thank you for revival tonight. Oh, God, yes, Lord. I know, yes, Lord, that there are many that believe that when we mention the word revival, Lord God, there are many that automatically think of a church gathering. They think of, oh, God, yes, Lord, a church service. But, Father, when we say revival, we take it as your word says it. And your word says to us, oh, God, will not God God. Revive thy word in the midst of the years. I'm asking you, oh God, revive thy work, oh God. Revive thy work, I pray. And when we say revive, yes, Lord, we understand that the word revive means to live again. Oh, Nanaya. I'm asking you in the name of Jesus. There are many, oh God, hallelujah, in the area, oh God, yes, Lord, in areas of their life where life has been snatched away, where life has been taken, oh God. But I'm asking you in the name of Jesus, I pray for revival tonight. I pray for revival tonight. Revive our drive in the name of Jesus. Revive our ambition in the name of Jesus. Revive our zeal, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Revive our passion. Oh, no, yes, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Revive our faith, oh God. Revive our trust. Revive us again, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Revive our prayer. It is in your word, oh God. When your word declares to us in the book of Genesis chapter 2 and verse number 7, oh God. When your word says, glory to God, that you formed man from the dust of the ground. Hallelujah. And your word declares that you breathe into his nostrils the breath of life. Glory to God, you breathe into his nostrils the breath of life. Glory to God. In the Greek, that means that you breathe into his nostrils the breath of Hayim. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. And if the word Hayim means the breath of lives, Father, you breathe not just life, but you breathe lives into him. And Father, the Bible says that man became a living soul. In other words, oh God, we know that, yes, Lord, a part of us, we are awake. But there's a part of us, oh God, that we need the breath of life. We need to be revived. We need a fresh wind of your glory. Breathe on us, I pray. Breathe on us, I pray. Breathe on us, I pray tonight. Breathe on us, oh God. Breathe on your people, I pray. Oh God, yes, Lord. Breathe on your people, I pray. Oh God, in the name of Jesus. It's not enough for us, oh God, just to have a temporary feel good. Father, yeah, Lord. Hallelujah to God. But Father, it's the drive that we desire. And the drive that we desire, oh God, is the drive that we want fulfilled on the inside. Oh God, yeah, Lord, I'm asking you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God, hallelujah, let the breath of God hit us in every area of our lives, in the name of Jesus, even those areas, oh God, where we've become slothful, in those areas where we've become complacent, in the name of Jesus, you called us, oh God, to a higher place in you, and Father, it's not enough for us to have a drive in one area and not a drive in the other. But Father, I pray tonight in the name of Jesus. And I also read in your word that when you desire to make us whole, you don't want to make us half whole. But if we're going to be whole, we're going to be whole all the way through. I'm asking you, oh God, from the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet, make us whole, I pray, oh God. Make us whole, I pray, Father. Make us whole, I pray, in the name of Jesus. We don't just want the heart like you and not have the mind of Christ. We don't just want the mind of Christ and not have the heart of Christ. Oh, nah, yes, Lord. We don't want the attitude of Christ, but yet our eyes are carnal. Father, I'm asking you, let us be spiritual, God. Thank you for a spiritual mind. Thank you for a spiritual heart. Thank you for spiritual ears. Thank you for spiritual eyes. Thank you for the body. Be a spiritual as well. In the name of Jesus. Oh God, yeah, Lord. Thank you for our tongue and our mouth, oh God. Be a spiritual as well. In the name of Jesus. In other words, oh God, when everything aligns itself, oh God, yes, Lord. When everything aligns itself with the will of God, oh God, we can't be you, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Align us with your will. Align us with your word. Align our minds. Align our mouths. Align our hearts. In the name of Jesus. Align us, oh God. Align us, oh God. Align us, oh God. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Align us, oh God. Oh, God, yes, Lord. I believe that when we seek you first, your kingdom and your righteousness, all of these other things will be added, oh God. In other words, I believe that when you align us in the spirit realm, then that's going to affect the natural realm. In other words, oh God, hallelujah, with you aligning us in the spirit, it's going to cause us to have our finances aligned. It's going to cause us to have our credit aligned. It's going to cause us to be good stewards, oh God, one to the other. It's going to cause us, Lord God, yes, Lord, not to have respect to person, but to treat everybody, oh God, as a child of God. I thank you now that our businesses are blessed. I thank you now that our finances are blessed. I thank you now, oh God, for the strategy so that we can represent the kingdom of God. Thank you now, oh God, that every area of my life will exemplify you. Every area of my life will exemplify you. The way that I handle people will exemplify you. The way that I talk will exemplify you. The way that I carry myself will exemplify you. What I speak will exemplify you. What I have will exemplify you. Where you take me will exemplify you. I give you praise now. I give you praise now. I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice. Oh, yeah, Lord. I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice. I thank you for revival tonight that's hitting the lives of everybody under the sound of my voice. I thank you for revival tonight. I thank you for revival tonight. Oh, God, yeah, Lord. I thank you for revival tonight. Oh, God. Those that are streaming with us, I thank you for revival. Revival, those that are in the playback, I thank you for revival in the name of Jesus. Breathe on us, I pray. Breathe on us, I pray. Breathe on every individual under the sound of my voice. Breathe upon every household, I pray. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God, yes, Lord. Breathe upon, oh, God. Hallelujah, jobs. Breathe upon, oh, God. Next level ministry. Breathe upon, oh, God. Hallelujah, next level saints. Breathe upon, oh, God. The next level of believers. In the name of Jesus, I give you glory tonight. In the name of Jesus. I give you praise tonight in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord God, for those that are sick. We pray for those that are in the hospitals. We pray for those that are in nursing homes. We pray for those that are dealing with some type of physical ailment in their bodies, oh God. Those that may be believing you for a miracle. Lord God, yes, Lord. If it's a miracle that they are expecting, then a miracle they shall have. If it's a miracle that they are expecting, then a miracle they shall have. In the name of Jesus, I believe you, oh God. I believe you, oh God. I read in your word. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. How you spoke a word and it manifested, not only in your word, but Father, I've seen with my own eyes, oh God. Glory to God, how we prayed. Hallelujah. And a miracle manifested. Glory to God. And so, Father, I believe that if you are the same God yesterday, today, and you will be forever. I believe now that as we speak the word, I decree and declare that a miracle, 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 that a miracle will hit. Thank you for a miracle. Thank you for healing miracles. Thank you for breakthrough miracles. In the name of Jesus. Thank you now, God, for miracles in the bodies of the saints, oh God. Thank you for miracles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I thank you for Sister Fatima. And I thank you for touching the body. I thank you for Brother Darian. And I thank you for touching his body. I thank you for all of those that we haven't called by name. Huh? And I thank you for touching their bodies. Huh? I thank you for Brother Charles Williams. Huh? I thank you for touching his body. Huh? I thank you for Mother Jeanette Pendergrass. Huh? I thank you for touching her body. Huh? I thank you now, God. Huh? Hallelujah. Huh? For all of those. Huh? Mother Bowie. Huh? Thank you for touching her body. Huh? Mother McKenzie. Huh? Thank you for touching her body, her cousin, thank you for touching her body, in the name of Jesus, thank you for touching their bodies, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord God, that you will continue to manifest yourself, we're praying, oh God, yes, Lord, and we're praying because we believe you, we're praying, oh God, yes, Lord, because despite of what it is that we may feel, we will not conform to this world. We will not conform, oh God, hallelujah, to what we feel. We will not conform, oh God, to what's been spoken in and over us that's contrary against your word and your will. We will not conform, Lord God, to even what our own minds that's outside of the will of God may be telling us. But oh God, yes, Lord, we believe the report of the Lord. And Father, I thank you that we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Thank you now. Thank you for it now. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, from the crown of our heads to the soles of our feet, that you will continue to manifest yourself, oh God. In the name of Jesus, that you will continue to manifest yourself. We believe that it's already done. Hallelujah. We believe that it's already done. We believe that it's already done. In the name of Jesus, we believe that it's already done. I thank you, oh God, for the body of Christ at large. I thank you, oh God, yes, Lord, for Bishop Michael Blue, Pastor Melinda. I thank you, oh God, and we pray even over this kingdom of the arts and media that's forthcoming. Father, we pray that you will go before, hallelujah, and have your way in this meeting. In the name of Jesus, I thank you for the body of Christ at large. We thank you, oh God, for what you're doing even in the life of Bishop Vera Davis and Nazareth. We thank you for what you're doing, oh God, yes, Lord, in the body of Christ at large. Thank you for what you're doing even in the community of Hope Fellowship. I thank you, oh God, for the favor of God. I thank you, oh God, yes, Lord, for where it is that you brought us from and where it is that you're taking us. We thank you for where we are even now. I give you praise for that, Father, because everything that we have asked of you, you have allowed it to come to full fruition. And I thank you for it right now. As you continue to manifest yourself, I pray that you will help us to remain in this posture. Help us to remain humble. Help us to remain meek. Help us, oh God, hallelujah, to remain at your feet. We come against any spirit of pride. We come against, oh God, any spirit of arrogancy. We come against any spirit, oh God, yes, Lord, hallelujah, that is not like you. Glory to God. And I give you praise because all that you have done in our lives and all that you are doing, Father, all of the glory belongs to you. And I thank you for it now. In the name of Jesus, Father, have your way in us all. And have your way through us all. Oh God, yes, Lord, I praise your name. Thank you that you're doing a new thing in us all. Thank you that you're doing a new thing in us all. And I give you praise for it now. All the glory belongs to you. All the honor belongs to you. All the praise belongs to you. And we will be sure to give it all to you. Yes, Lord, we will be sure to give it all to you. We pray for the plight of our nation. We pray, Lord God, for our governmental leaders as well. Father, we pray that you will have mercy. Have mercy on all that is going on in our world. Those, oh God, yes, Lord, hallelujah, that have been involved in accidents. Those, oh God, that have been involved, oh God, and that are dealing with some form of bereavement. Father, we pray, Lord God, for O.J. Simpson's family. We pray for his children and all of those that are connected and those that have been affected by this death. Father, I pray that you will cover them and comfort them like only you can. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord God, hallelujah, glory to God, for our leaders of this nation. We pray for President Biden. We pray for Vice President Harris. We pray, Lord God, yes, Lord, for all of our governmental leaders, our senators, our mayors. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch the hearts of these leaders. Touch the hearts of these leaders. And then, of course, we pray, Lord, for the plight of this entire world, with wars that are going on and rumors of wars. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And even as your word described about earthquakes in different places, Father, I thank you because you told us to sorrow not because the end is not yet. But yet in seeing all of these things, Father, I pray, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that if there has been any spirit of fear that have set in on your people, if there has been any spirit of hold back and set back, any spirit of stress or distress, Father, we come against it now in the name of Jesus, because we know that the enemy wants to use something to be the source of fear. But Father, you have not given us the spirit of fear, but of that of power, love, and of a sound mind. And so, Father, help us to utilize what it is that you have given us. If you have given us power, then no longer will we sit, hallelujah, as though we don't have a way through this. No longer will we sit as though we're waiting for you, Lord God, to do what it is that we ask of you. In other words, Father, the only way that you're going to do what it is that we ask of you is that there's a part that we must fulfill as well. And so, Father, I thank you. Hallelujah. I give you praise now that we do what it is that you have called us to do. I thank you for it now. All of those that are lost, all of those in whom the God of this world have blinded their minds, Father, I thank you that their eyes are open, the eyes of their understanding, the eyes of their minds have been opened. Glory to God, hallelujah. And I thank you right now that they receive you for who you are. We give you praise for it now. All the glory and honor belongs to you. In the name of the Lord Jesus. My brothers and sisters, you agree with that prayer this evening. And you believe God, if you would stand to your feet, if you would stand to your feet, everyone, glory to God, hallelujah. And if you believe God and you believe him, that he is the God who doesn't just hear our prayer, but he is also the God who answers our prayers, hallelujah. Would you lift your hands and begin to bless the Lord out of your mouth? Would you lift your hands and begin to bless the Lord out of your spirit? Would you lift your hands and begin to bless the Lord as though, hallelujah, you believe that what it is that you have requested of him, what it is that you have petitioned of him, it is already done. Hanaya. Yes, Lord, you believe it. Open up your mouth and praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. 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 We bless your name. 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 We bless your name tonight. Hallelujah. We bless your name. For yours is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. Thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Find three people and tell them one at a time, I believe that something good is about to happen to you. Go ahead and tell them, I believe that something good is about to happen to you. I believe that something good is about to happen to you. YouTube, I believe that something good is about to happen to you. Conference call, I believe that something good is about to happen to you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You may be seated, my brothers and sisters. Thank God for you. Thank God for you, and thank God again for this opportunity and this time that the Lord has given us. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank God for the privilege of prayer, and thank God for being able to go to the Lord, to seek the Lord in prayer. I honor the Lord for it. I do. I honor the Lord and I give him praise for that. Because, my brothers and sisters, I do know that as the saints of old would say, prayer changes things. Yeah, I believe that now. Prayer changes things. And then I heard somebody say prayer also changes people. Praise God. I believe that as well. But one of the main things I believe is that prayer will change you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Yeah. And so, yeah, prayer changes things. Prayer changes people. But prayer will also change you. Hallelujah. And that's contingent upon you yielding yourself to the Lord and you allowing God to change you. You're allowing God to change you. And my brothers and sisters, we know that God is not a God who just forces himself on, he doesn't force himself on anyone. He doesn't force himself to do anything. But God, when he sees that you yield yourself to him, and what I mean by that, you yielding yourself to him, that is you saying to the Lord, I present myself. I come to you, and I come to you asking you to do whatever it is that you want to do in my life. I'm not resenting, I'm not fighting back, but I present my body as a living sacrifice, right? He says, holy and acceptable unto God. Praise the name of the Lord. He says, which is your reasonable service? And then he goes on to say, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Praise God. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We were here briefly on this past Monday. And the Lord has laid this upon our hearts. And it has been confirmed while we were praying just a few moments ago. While we were praying. And how it is that we must understand and keep in our minds and in our spirits that just the recent statement that I just made, which is understanding and knowing that God will not do anything that you and I don't allow him to do. In other words, if we don't allow God to do it, if we don't posture ourselves and get in the place for God to do what it is that we are believing him to do, God is not a God, again, who forces himself. But if the Bible says to us that the spirit, or the body rather, the body without the spirit is dead, and then it goes on to say to us, so then faith without works is dead also. And so that means, my brothers and sisters, that a lot of times, instead of you and I sitting on the sideline waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting for God to do what it is that we are believing him to do, there is a part in which we must play as believers so that God can do what it is that he wants to do. He's waiting for you to allow him to do it. Which means if you want the Lord to come into your life, the Bible tells us in the book of the Revelation, he says, behold, I stand, Jesus is speaking, he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock, right? That's what he said. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Notice he didn't say, I stand at the door, and by the time I count to three, I'm going to bust the door down, right? He doesn't say, I stand at the door with a jackhammer or, some type of door wedge to break the door in. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if any man will hear my voice, all right, and let me in, he said, then will I come in and sup with you. In other words, the Lord is saying that, yes, I want to come into your life, but the only way that I'll be able to come into your life is that you must open the door. All right? I'm knocking at the door, but the doorknob is on the inside. The doorknob is on the inside, and so therefore I'm not forcing my way in. Hallelujah. I'm not going to bombard my way in, but the only way I'm going to be able to come in and sup with you or dine with you or fellowship with you is that you must let me in. Right? You must let me in. And a lot of times we would take texts like this, because this is what religious people do. Nothing against religious people. I heard one preacher say he disliked religious people, and you know, to some degree, I understand the concept of what he meant by that. But what religious people have thought for so long is that when you read a text as such, that just means in some form of a spiritual setting. Right, I want Jesus to come in, and when they use that particular text and they make reference to that being a spiritual setting, what they're saying is, I'm just waiting for the wind of God to come in. I'm waiting for the right song or the right music to hit so that everybody starts shouting, everybody start dancing, everybody start running, everybody start sweating, and then we just leave and go home. Nobody's been changed. Right? And I'm not afraid to say to you, thank you for that verse too, brother. But I'm not afraid to say for so long, that's all I thought Jesus was. You know, I mean, I'm talking about me. You know, I'm not talking about anybody else, so you can't say I'm bothering you. But I thought that, you know, when people read different texts like that, and I'm just waiting on the Holy Ghost to come in, you know, they're just waiting on the Holy Ghost so that everybody can bump into one another, run into the wall, we leave and go home. And sad to say, that's what a lot of people still think today, is that when the Holy Ghost come in, you know, it's about child, we having a good time, and nobody's life has been changed. Nobody's life has been touched. Nobody's life has been transformed. It's just been about a religious circus, all right? A religious circus, and you know what a circus is, so we don't have to go through all of that, but a religious circus. We do all what we do, and, you know, and so I believe that part of the reason why the body or the church world is in the state that it is in, no indictment at all, but part of the reason why the church world is in the state that it is in, it's because, you heard me say it before, Brother Kirk Franklin said it, Kirk Franklin rather, and he says that in his song, GP, are you with me? GP meant God's people or God's property. He said, are y'all with me? And they all hollered out, oh yeah, we have in church and we ain't going nowhere. And, you know, they were singing it behind them, stomping it all. We having church, we ain't going nowhere. And they told the truth on that. We having church, and, you know, we're not going anywhere. We're not moving anywhere. We're not going forward. And you can kind of see that because most don't really take the word of God as God would have you and I take his word. And what I mean by that is, if the Lord has said something concerning you and I, and we read it and we feel good about it, and the preacher preach it, and he preach it in such a way where he tune up a little bit, he get to hollering some, and the organ players behind him, and they tuned up with him or whatnot, and he's saying what it is that the word of God is saying, but yet if we don't believe what the scripture is saying, then again, we are just part of that whole circus that's going on. Sad. But we're just part of the whole circus that's going on, jumping and shouting and sweating and running into one another, but yet there has been no transformation that has taken place in our lives. The Lord says through the Apostle Paul here in the book of 1 Corinthians, I'm looking at the screen, but in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 3, praise God, the Bible says to us in verse number nine, right? And I believe the Lord gives us grace. You know, we'll have time to kind of deal with this a little more deeper and a little more extensively, you know, even with the verse prior and even some after. But I just want to deal with this verse number 9 right now, where the word of the Lord says concerning you and I, for we, that includes you, that's me, that's all of us. The Bible says, for we are laborers together with God, right? We are laborers. In other words, we are workers. We are workers together with God. You know, and so again, going back to this religious talk and, you know, what it is that have been shared with us, I'm not beating up the church. I promise you I'm not. But again, when you don't understand these particular wordings and you don't understand the scripture, it can have you going in cycles. It can have you going in circles. It can have you going in cycles. And part of the reason why the children of Israel, and I'm not going to deal with them long, but part of the reason why the children of Israel stayed going in cycles, stayed going in circles. Bring in the New Testament, Reb. The reason why the disciples could not cast out the devil that was in this deaf and dumb little boy was simply because, my brothers and sisters, they heard the word, glory to God, but they did not take the word for what it was supposed to be taken of or for. Right? And so if we are laborers together with God, then that means we must understand that we are not laborers for God. Right? We are laborers together with God, not laborers together for God, which means we're not working for him. Follow what I'm saying? We are not working for God. We are workers, laborers. How? With God. That's scripture. Right? The Bible says we are laborers together with him, which means that we are working with God. We are working with him. That makes sense? We are working with him. Well, Rev, I thought they said that God don't need your help. Truth of the matter is he don't. Right? He don't need your help, but Lord, he doesn't need our help. But if you understand Genesis 1:26, I told you that text changed my whole life, right? And I meant that. And that is because if the Bible says to us in Genesis 1:26 that we are all made in the image of God and after the likeness of God, I go to this text all the time because I am a believer in knowing that if we don't get the foundation of what it is that God wants us to get, know where we come from, know why we're created, know why we're here, and know where we're going, we're going to miss the whole aspect of why we're even here. So Genesis 1:26, if he says we're made in his image and we're made after his likeness, Jesus, or God rather, he did that because God understood, hear me closely now, God understood that in order for his mandate and what it is that he wants to do could be fulfilled in the earth, he needed a body. Okay? He needed a body. And so, yeah, I get God don't need your help, and he doesn't. He's sovereign. He does anything how he wants to do it, when he wants to do it. However, for God to fulfill, and if you and I are the express image of him, express image means that if we are the ones that are glory carriers, we're carrying something that belongs to him. All right? And so if the glory can't move on its own, that means that somebody has to carry the glory. You follow what I'm saying? Somebody has to carry it. One of us has to carry it. And so therefore, even when you get to the Gospel of John, chapter number 9, and here you got a blind man that's blind, and the disciples immediately ask, Jesus, who sinned for this man to be blind? Did he sin? Did his mom and dad sin? Jesus said, nobody sinned. I just wanted him to carry my glory. You follow what I'm saying? I want to hear, and so therefore, I caused him to be blind, hallelujah, and the reason why I caused him to be blind is because I want y'all to see that although he was born blind, he don't have to be stuck blind. Right? Although he was born blind, he don't have to get complacent in being blind. What are you saying to us, Reb? I'm saying that even where you are in your life, hallelujah, you're spending too much time trying to figure out how I got here. When all you need to understand is if I'm a glory carrier, that means I'm not going to be here long. I'm a glory carrier. And so therefore, if I'm carrying the glory of God, then that means, hallelujah, that eventually what's on me gonna have to break. Why is that? It's because I trust God. And I trust him to the point that if he said I'm already healed, you will hear me here. If he said I'm already delivered, if he said I'm already set free, glory to God, I'm not trying to figure out what other symptoms is going to relate to what it is and why it is that I'm here. I'm already healed. I'm just a glory carrier. And so therefore, I must trust the process. It's just a process that I must trust. All right? All of that is based upon you and I taking him at his word, right? When you take him at his word, you're not questioning why you are where you are. When you take him at his word, you're not sitting there pouting, mumbling, and complaining. That's what got the children of Israel in trouble. They mumbled, they complained. They complained, they mumbled. They mumbled, they complained. They complained and mumbled till it became a cycle, and they never saw the promised land because they didn't take God at his word. If his word said, I already have a prepared place, however you look at it, I'm going to get there. All right? And so however long I got to go through this dilemma or go through what it is that I'm wrestling and fighting with, all I know is that I'm made in his image. I'm made after his likeness. That's one thing. But then I also know that we are workers. We are laborers together with him. If I'm hired on and I'm working with the healer, I'm working with the deliverer, I know that everything I need is on board with me. It's on board with me, right? We are laborers together with God, right? We are God's husbandry. That's what the Bible says. We are God's building. God is not going to allow his building to be sick, right? God does not want his building to be sick. He does not want his building to be stagnated. He does not want his building to be complacent. And so therefore, if we are laborers together with him, then that means, my brothers and sisters, that everything that you may be facing, everything you may be dealing with, everything that may feel heavy or burdensome to you, you and I must understand that, listen, I work with God, all right? I work with God. I work with him. And I say that because, you know, we use the text over in the Gospel of Luke. We use the text where the Bible says, I believe it's Luke chapter 5, when the Bible says that Jesus, he saw these two ships and he saw that they were empty. And the Bible says that he entered into one of the ships and he went out into the water or whatnot, and he began to sit and teach those that were around him. Bible said when he came back, he noticed that Simon Peter was washing his nets. Right, he was washing, he was cleaning his nets because, you know, Simon, one of the disciples, that's one thing, but then by trade, Simon was a fisherman, right? So he's a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, but he is also by trade a fisherman. What I mean by trade, he's a professional fisherman. This is what he does. This is how he lives. This is how he eats. Right? This is how he pays his bills, as you and I would say. And so Jesus noticed that Brother Simon was washing his nets. And Jesus said to him, I'm paraphrasing this, you know, I know you washing out your nets or whatnot, you know, packing up, getting ready to leave. He said, but go out and cast your nets one more time. Right? Go out there and drop it one more time. Simon's response to Jesus was, I do this, okay? All right, this is what I do. By trade, this is what I do, okay? By trade, it's a whole lot in that. But he's letting them know that by trade, this is what I do, okay? By trade, this is what I do. I fish, okay? I fish, I'm a fisherman, okay? And so you're telling me to go back out here when, Master, we've been out here all night. Okay, we done been out here toiling all night long, and you mean to tell me you want me to go back out here again? I believe that what Simon wasn't understanding was the fact that, yeah, although he was out there without Jesus. Come on here, all right? He was out there, and although, yeah, this is what I do, and this is who I am by trade, you still need Jesus. Come on here. I don't care how professional you are. I don't care how much it is. It comes to you. At the end of the day, if you don't have Jesus, you don't have nothing. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You can have a license to fish. You can be on TBN fishing or wherever else fishing. Glory to God. The top man of the world, without Jesus on your side, you are completely nothing. He says, but at thy word, you know, in other words, since you said so, I'll go back out here. Okay? I'll go back out here. Here's my point, even on that. Because I just said to you earlier that God is sovereign. Jesus is sovereign. He does what he wants to do, and he does it whenever he wants to do it. Okay? And I say that because notice this. Jesus could have easily, Lord, I praise your name. Because if you go back to Genesis 1:26, and the Bible talks about how we're made in his image, how we're made after his likeness, and then even after that, he said to us that we should have dominion over the fish of the sea. Okay? And I'll just stop there. Because my point simply is that if we could have dominion over the fish of the sea, then simply and easily, Jesus could have spoke to the sea and told the fish, get in Simon's boat. Follow what I'm saying? Say it again, Rev. If we are to have dominion over the fish of the sea, all right? Glory to God. Jesus could have easily spoke to the fish and told the fish, glory to God, get in Simon's boat. And guess what the fish would have had to do? Get in the boat, right? Because if Jesus created the fish, the Bible says in the book of 1 John chapter number 1, not 1 John, the Gospel of John, John chapter number 1 at verse number 3, you know 1 and 1, where it says in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He goes on to verse 2, all things were made by him. Verse number 3, and not in. He said, verse number 3, all things were made by him, and was not anything made that was made. All right? All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Which means if God made Simon, if God made the boat, if God made the nets, then surely God made the fish. Okay? And so therefore, he says, Simon, go back out there and cast your net one more time, right? Cast it down into the deep. But again, Jesus could have easily said, fish, swim up to Simon's boat and jump in the boat, all right? All the fish, get in the boat and get in Simon's boat. He could have easily said that. How do you know that, Reb? Because again, if you just went back to the Gospel of Mark chapter number 4, the Gospel of Mark chapter number 4, you'll understand that it was around verse number 35 that Jesus had just told his disciples, get in the ship, we're going to the other side. All right? The Bible says that Jesus got on the boat and went to sleep. You remember that story, right? And when he went to sleep, the Bible says that the disciples went down to shake him, waking him up. And they're waking him up because, wait a minute, Jesus, there's a storm out here. Right? There's a storm out here. The Bible says that Jesus wakes up, right? He wakes up and Jesus asks them, why are you so fearful? In other words, what you scared of? The Bible says he was in the hinder part of the sleep, asleep on the pillow, and they awake him and they said unto him, Master, carest not thou that we, you don't care that we about to die? Whoa, okay? And I say whoa because Jesus just said, get in the ship, we're going to the other side. Now you come to me and you say, you don't care that we about to die? Who told you was about to die? All right? Where'd you get that from? What's your point, Rev? My point simply is, fear will have you speaking some crazy stuff. All right? I just said the creator of the whole universe, the creator of the ship, the creator of the water that you own, I just said to you, and whom I created as well, get in the boat, we're going to the other side. You came to me and saw a storm and immediately said, Lord, you don't care, we about to die. You don't care. You don't care that we're about to perish. Go to verse number 39. Praise God. The Bible says, he arose. I'm talking about Jesus now. And he arose and rebuked the wind. Rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. What happened? The wind ceased. Y'all Bible say that too, right? Oh, yeah. The wind ceased and there was a great calm. All right? And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? Right. What scared you? He says, how is it that you have no faith? I'm talking about workers together with God. Right? He said, how is it that you have no faith? Go ahead on to verse number 41. And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this, right? That even the wind and the sea obey him, right? Stay right there. What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Which backs me up or backs up my statement that Jesus could have easily spoke to the sea, right? He just said the wind and the sea obey him. He could have easily spoke to the sea and said, fish, get out the water and get in Simon's boat. Because the word of the Lord says that the disciples asking the question, what manner of man is this? That the storm, the wind, the thunder, the lightning, and even the sea obeys him. Right? So that backs up our statement that yes, he could have easily said, fish, get out the water and get into Simon's boat. And the sea would have had, and the fish would have had to obey him, right? Well, you might ask the question, well then, Jesus, Reb, if that is so, why did Jesus tell Simon to go back out into the boat, into the water, and throw his net down one more time? I'll tell you why. It is because if we are going to be 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse number 9, which is workers and laborers together with God, then that simply means that God wants you to cooperate with him. He wants you to partner with him so that he can fulfill what it is that you are believing God for. You see what I'm saying? We're workers together with him. So Simon, you're not just a disciple or you're not just a fisherman. You are my co-worker. All right? You're my co-worker. And so therefore, if you are my co-worker, then all I'm asking you to do is go back and do what it is that you've been doing. No, master, I've been doing this all night. No, go back out there and do what you've been doing. Right? Go back out there and do what you've been doing. But I'm a professional at this and ain't nothing biting tonight. Go back out there and do what you've been doing. But I've been out here talling all night and ain't nothing came in. Go back out there and do what it is that you've been doing. You do your part, I'll do my part. What happens? The Bible says that by the time Simon goes and thrusts out the net on the into the deep, they bring in so great of a multitude of fish that it began to break the net. The nets begin to break. And they begin to break all because, number one, Simon did what he was told to do. All right? He obeyed the Lord. And what that showed Simon is that if I'm working with God, it's not so much of God being the fisherman, it's so much of me doing what it is that my co-worker instructed me to do. If I'm a laborer, if I'm a worker together with him, praise God, and I'm out here to catch fish, my thing is, if I do what it is that I'm called to do, which is my part, then God is going to do his part. The whole point is that if we, you and I, are laborers together with God, the only thing God is expecting you to do is that in which you are able to do. He's not expecting you to be Superman. That's who he is, right? He's not expecting you to be the supernatural. That's who he is. He's the supernatural. In other words, you do the possible, right? He does what's impossible for us, all right? There are certain things that, yeah, we can't do. But there are certain things that we can do. Hallelujah. And the Bible says it this way. All things are possible to him. To who? To him that believes. All right? And so therefore, if you're going to believe God, your believing is also co-partnering with him. And if we are laborers together with God, then you must make sure that you're not one of those that's just sitting on the sideline saying, I'm waiting on God to do it for me. Your job is to do what it is that God has called you to do and then leave the rest in his hands. All right? Someone was singing the song, I put it all in his hands. Well, don't put it all in his hands. There's some that need to be in your hands. All right? There's something that you need to do. But ultimately, I know what you're saying. God is going to do it, but God is also waiting for you to partner with him so that this can be done. And yes, all the glory goes to him, but when you do your part and you allow God to do his part, everything is going to be manifested. You see what I'm saying? And so therefore, as we close it, as we close this, we close it in saying that if God is the God who the Bible says that the wind and the sea must obey him, if he's the God, my brothers and sisters, and even as we quoted so many times before, that if he has breathed himself into you and I, if he has breathed himself into you and I, then that means that there's certain things that you and I can speak as well, but we must speak, number one, in faith, but we also must speak believing that what comes out of our mouth is already done in the name of the Lord. Said another way, God's word in his mouth is like God's word in my mouth. That's how our pastor would say it. God's word in his mouth is just like God's word in my mouth, which simply means that if he speak the word and things have to fall in line, then I'm a child of God. I can speak the word and things must fall in line as well. You follow what I'm saying? That's just like when we talk about putting on the whole armor of God. Putting on the full armor of God confuses the enemy. Because the enemy don't know who's in the armor. All he knows is that it's God's armor that's coming. All right? We got the armor of God on. And so the enemy has to bow to the armor of God. He don't know who's on the inside. He don't know if it's God on the inside or if it's you on the inside. All he sees is that the armor of God is coming his way. God's word in his mouth is just like God's word in your mouth. All right? If God can speak it and it come to fruition, you must know that you can speak it and it's going to be manifested as well. You see that? Father, thank you that even as we have attempted to share tonight here in your word, it is our prayer and it is always our prayer that we have not and that we know we will not ever, Lord God, as long as we have anything to do with it, waste your time. But Father, I thank you that what it is that we have attempted to share has been received in such a way where we will know who we are in you and whose we are, and that we will begin to operate under and by the power of the Lord Jesus the Christ. Hallelujah. We give you praise for it now. All glory and honor belongs to you. In the name of the Lord Jesus the Christ, we do pray for the glory and the honor of God. Amen and amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Listen, my brothers and sisters, as we conclude tonight, as we bring this to a close, we dare not close without giving you opportunity, as we so often do, giving you opportunity, giving you time, that if there is some type of commentary that you would like to share, a question that you may want to oppose to the saints or to myself or anyone, or if there is something that may have blessed you and you want to share what it is that have stood out, what it is that have blessed you, we want to give you opportunity now. Any type of commentary concerning the lesson, we want to give you opportunity now to give whatever commentary you have in regards to the lesson. And so if that's you, whether you on the YouTube, whether you're in the room, the floor is open at this time. You may say what it is that you have, or that's all what's on your heart to say. You have the floor at this time.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him.
I thank God for the teaching on tonight. And I have two things I wanted to express. One is 1 Corinthians 3 and 9. I never really thought about that scripture in the way that you presented it to us tonight, that we are laborers together with God.
That's right.
And I know that you normally, you know, when you're making decisions or you have issues, you know, and you pray about it, sometimes you're not sure exactly where your part began or end, and where you're supposed to allow God to come in and do his part. But this kind of really clears it up. You do what you know is in your power to do.
That's right.
And then you trust God. Mm-hmm. And that the the phrase trust in God is just becoming more alive every time I hear it. And it works so well in everyday life. Amen. You know, believing, having faith, trusting God, all of that. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to say how so much of what you said tonight is a revelation, you know, beneficial revelation, and it goes so well with what you, I mean, like, the things that you've learned, I mean, it's kind of not like turning it around, but it's giving you a new perception of the Word of God, that you are able to use this. I mean, because in all of my life, I've never thought in terms of using the Word the way that you teach us, how it helps us every day with everything that comes our way. Amen. You know, talking to the Lord. When your eyes open in the morning, you gotta start thanking God, bringing Him into your day, all day long, throughout the day. God is turning things around. So a lot of times you don't look back and see what God is doing, but He is so active in your life and blessing you and protecting you and providing for you and keeping you. You don't realize, and then you go home and put your head on the pillow at night, and you just doze off to sleep. Wake up the next morning, never giving God the credit that He is due. But God is so here for us, Amen. So present for us, to help us, to be the people that He spent His time putting this Bible together so that we'll have a better life. And I praise God for the understanding and the revelation that always come from these teaching sessions and also for prayer sessions on Monday morning and also Sunday teaching too. All of it, praise the Lord. My question now on top of all of that is, what is it that you think made Peter change his mind? He was the professional, and he was listening to someone else who I assumed that he felt wasn't. But what do you think that made him change his mind and listen to what Jesus was telling him?
That's a good question. That's a good question. And I, too, have thought of that, too. And I've come up with two answers in thinking about that and meditating on that myself. And one was, and this one is what stood out to me, one was the way that Peter responded back to Jesus. I can't necessarily say I know the tone that Peter had when he responded, but the tone in how I read it, and I'm talking about me now, the tone in how I read it came across as though, we've been out here all night long. We have not caught anything. But just so I can show you ain't nothing biting, I go back out here. In other words, he says, at thy word, all right? He says, Master, we've been talking all night, okay? That sounds like a bit of a frustrating tone to me. You know, we've been talking all night, all right? We've been out here, we've been talking all night, and we've caught nothing. But at that word, you know, sound like he a little disturbed, you know? But at that word, in other words, but just so I can prove to you ain't nothing biting tonight, I'm going to go back out here and throw these nets down. And I believe that in terms, Jesus allowed there to be a net-breaking multitude of fish come in, because although where it may have could have been one or two fish, or even as we mentioned during the lesson, Jesus could have easily said, fish, get in the boat. You know, but I believe that because of the tone that I believe Peter had, Jesus had something for him too. All right. And what Jesus wanted to prove to Peter was, if you do what I say do, then I'm going to cause there to be an overflow in such a way where you're not even going to be able to tame it. Because the Bible says that by the time they drew in the fish, that they weren't even able to get all of them in because the net started breaking. So my answer is, I'm not going to necessarily say this changed Peter's mind to some degree, of course. Yeah, it had to. But I just believe that Peter just went back out because Jesus told him to go back out. That's my answer. I think Peter just went because he was instructed by Jesus to go. And so he just, again, at thy word, I'll go out here. That's a good question.
Bless God. That is a very good question. I was thinking, and my mind went to something, and I wasn't going to say anything because as you were teaching, you kind of came back and you said something, and I didn't want to be contradictive or come across as being contradictive as to what it is that you were saying. And I don't think that I will be, but you and I had a conversation today, and this fell in line with a lot of what we were talking about. And so it says in the Bible here, it says that they were washing their nets with the letter S at the end, which meant multiple. And so when Simon actually cast his net, which is one, that's not what he was told to do. He was partially obedient, in my opinion. He was obedient, as you said, to show you that, okay, this is what I know what I'm talking about, but because you want me to do it, I done washed these other nets, and I'm not going back through that again. So because I know what I'm talking about, I'm going to throw this one net out here, because I'm only willing to wash one again with it just being nothing in it. I'm going to throw it back out. I say all of that to bring it back to my own personally. I went to school for massage therapy, and I was told by my husband, which is a trusted voice to me, that there was something that was in my hands, and I agreed only because I know what I had been praying and asking God to use, how to use me. I asked God to use my hands to be able to help others, healing. I asked him to use my hands, and so when it was spoken to me through the trusted voice, I believe that you should go to school for massage therapy. I went. I passed the classes and everything. I got my diploma, but I went to take my test to get my license, and I failed it. So the first time I cried and I got discouraged, but I went back the second time because this is what the trusted voice inspired me to do, was to go back. But I believe that within myself it was, I'm not going to get it. But because of the trusted voice, I went back the second time. And so after the second time, I just let it go because I still didn't pass. But now it's been brought back to me, just in a random conversation, it's been brought back to me. And in the conversation that we had, doesn't mean that I'm going to get it the third or the fourth time, I don't know. But if I change my mindset as to where I believe and I trust God, I stand on his word, and this is what, if you said I can have it, if I ask you, I know what I asked you for, if I give the word back to him, I trust and I believe that it is so, that it is for me, that it is going to happen. And so instead of doing it partially and, you know, not doing it all the way, this time I got to do it just like he said. If he told me to cast the nets with the S, then I got to give it my all and not just partial. So in obeying God, I believe that we must be careful how. Not partial obedience, but full obedience. And so I just, like I said, that came to me because when Pastor said that, you know, Simon was actually obedient, I was like, okay, well, maybe I shouldn't say that, you know, but in my opinion, it was a partial obedience. And so that's the reason why the net broke, because God is able to do exceeding abundantly. He's not going to do anything halfway. So if he told you to cast them all, then cast them all. Trust him all the way. So I just bless God for that. And I hope that that helps someone.
Ultimately, you must understand that the enemy's job is to create some form of failure in your mind. And what I mean by that, he wants to create failure. But what we tend to believe is that when we fail at a thing, we are now failures. And that's not true. Because if you fail at a thing, that doesn't deem you to be a failure. But if you allow that to be created in your mind, then it's going to cause you to respond to a whole lot of things differently. What I mean by that is, just along the lines of what you said, one of the reasons Peter began to wash his nets was because he felt as though he has now become a failure because they failed at catching fish that night. And so therefore, when Jesus comes back to him and tells him to take his nets, you know, again, failure, according to that text, failure will have you thinking, okay, well, I know what you said, but for me to prove to you what it is that's not actually happening, I'm not taking all these nets that I done cleaned. In other words, I don't wash my dishes now. Don't mess my dishes up. You understand what I'm saying? And so therefore, instead of me putting all these plates back out here on this table, I'm just going to take one plate back out here. All right? And again, he wasn't able to get all that God had for him because he only went with one plate. All right? What caused him to go with one plate? I believe that the failing in his mind had him thinking that now I'm a failure, so therefore I'm not going back with my all. That makes sense? I'm not going back with everything because I didn't catch anything here. I'm not wasting time dragging these nets back out here. All right? Jesus said, go cast your nets. Simon said, at thy word, I will cast the net. All right? Jesus said, cast your nets. Peter said, at thy word, I'll take the net. And so although God had grace on him, he still missed what could have been for him. I think, brother, I think you had it up there. Yeah. He said, now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a drought. Verse number 5, Simon answered and said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. So he missed what God had because he didn't give God his all. And he didn't give God his all because I don't wash these nets. And so maybe in his mind, I'm not dirtying up my nets no more. And sometimes we too can miss God because what we failed at has now birthed inside of us that we are failures, and now we are skeptical and holding back as to what we give God. In other words, if your heart has ever been broken, it's hard for you to trust somebody and give them your whole heart all over again. You know what I'm saying? Good point.
Well, I thank the Lord for the lesson on tonight, and I really thank the Lord for the ninth verse in 1 Corinthians about we are laborers together, and thank the Lord for how you broke that down, because what I get out of that, God, he wants us to be with him. I mean, and I feel like we are special. What did Scripture say? We are peculiar people, mm-hmm. And God don't want to leave us behind. He wants us to be up right with him. Because we are so special. He loves us.
That's right.
So I appreciate the Lord. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank the Lord for that. And I did get that out of the lesson on tonight.
Praise God. Praise God. That's good. And yeah, when you understand that part of it, in terms of us being laborers together with him, being a laborer means that we are participants, all right? And when we participate with him, we engage, we join, we get involved, we do all of these things because we're partnering with God. We're partnering with him, right? So that's good. Anyone else with anything else? Anyone else with anything else? Any other questions? Any other commentary? Praise God. Well, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord again for all that has been said and done, all that the Lord is doing. We appreciate the Lord tonight. We appreciate the Lord for the word. We appreciate the Lord for what he's doing in our lives. We appreciate the Lord for what he's doing in the life of the Community of Hope as well. They are making strides over at our new location. And so we bless the Lord for that. They are making great strides. I was down here earlier today. I've been out here pretty much every day this week, one and two times a day. But it's all business. But I was here today, and they were doing some work over. And when I got there, the workers there were telling me how when they began to do certain things today, they had to cut some concrete today inside. And when they began to cut concrete, they said fire trucks and everything pulled up at the building with the sirens and everything on. And they said they stopped working and ran outside. And say the firefighter said that they was getting calls from down that way saying that the building was on fire. But really, it was just smoke coming out. I said, well, brother, you just let them know that it ain't on fire yet, right? It ain't on fire yet, but it will be on fire real soon. And we're not talking about the type of fire where the fire trucks got to come and spray water, praise God. But we're talking about the fire of God that we believe not to just hit that building, but to hit that whole area and this area as well. We believe God for great things. And so listen, just keep praying, and let's keep believing God. God is still showing favor, and he's still blessing us. And I'm so grateful to the Lord. I'm so grateful for what the Lord is doing. And so again, let's just keep praying. Let's keep believing God. And great things are going to be manifest in the come of all of this. Let's continue to be in prayer one for the other. As we mentioned earlier, we want to continue to pray for Sister Fatima. I know she's home, but let's continue to pray for full recovery. And then, of course, I want you to continue to pray for Brother Darian. We call him DP, but that's Brother Darrell and Sister Renika's son. Let's pray that God will bring full healing to his body as well. Thank God for what it is and how it is that he's brought him thus far. But we're believing God. And even those that have requests and those that have petitions in which you are believing God for, we're believing God with you. And if it's a miracle that you are expecting, as we mentioned in prayer, then a miracle I do believe you shall receive. I felt like I was missing something, but I think we kind of covered it all for the most part. Shall we all stand? Shall we all stand? Yes, I know Kingdom of the Arts began. And so those of you who do want to be a part of that Kingdom of the Arts festival that's happening at the Door of Hope, that's going to begin tomorrow. Yes, tomorrow. And to make sure I have my days right, that's going to begin tomorrow through Saturday, maybe through Sunday. And so if you desire to be in attendance with that, you're certainly welcome to do so. I'm sorry. Yes, and Sister Lavelle's grandbaby, thank you for that. Sister Lavelle's granddaughter is going to be having a procedure next week, a week from today. And so we're praying and we're believing God that God is going to guide, that God is going to heal, and we're believing God already for full recovery as well. And so let's join our faith with the family's faith, and let's believe God that he is going to do what it is that he does. Yes. Praise God. He's going to do what it is that he does. And all other needs of the saints, other needs of the people that we may not have before us, let's be in prayer and let's believe God. We're going to recite the books tonight as we normally close out. And so, my brothers and sisters, let's recite the books together, and then we'll give final prayer and benediction. Praise God. Books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, Israel, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Michael, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, Jude, Revelation. Father, thank you for all that has been said and done. Thank you for what our ears have heard, what our hearts have felt. Thank you for your word, because your word is ever settled in heaven. We pray, Lord God, that we will take your word and that we will apply it to our lives, that we will live thereby. Father, continue to carry us and keep us, and let the remainder of this week be a blessed, prosperous, and favorable week. And all that we put forth our hands to do, we decree and declare that it shall be done. We believe that as we speak your word will manifest and come to life in our lives. And we give you glory for it now. In the name of the Lord Jesus, cover us and keep us and bring us all back at the appointed hour, that we'll be able to give unto you all the glory, honor, and the praise that are due unto your name. These blessings we ask in the name of the great God who is our Savior, the Lord Jesus the Christ. And now the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Say these words: we are. What the word of God says that we are. Say, we have what the word of God says that we have. And we can do what the word of God says that we can do. Say, for we are committed to bring pleasure to Christ's heart and fame to his name. May God bless you, my brothers and sisters. And until we meet again, may the peace of God go and be with you all. God bless you.